Gyaneshwari, chapter 15, verse number 7. Shuru ho gaya?
No, we have to start.
We have to start number 7. In the previous verse, the sun does not illuminate, nor the moon, nor the fire, after going where men return not. That is my supreme abode. So, what was that verse? Na tad bhasayate suryah, na shashanko na pavakah, yad gatvana nivartante tad dhama paramam mama. So, it is that light of all lights. It is the source of all lights. There are no lokas. Surya lok is where the Lord Sun is. Satya lok is where Lord Brahma is. But this abode, this light of all lights, is that which is transcendental to everything. And once having reached, a person has got no... He is free from the cyclical birth and rebirth. And in this way, having told that, now the Lord is telling Arjuna about what is the Jiva. From here the biography of the Jiva begins. Here he says, Mamaivansho Jiva Loke Jiva Bhutas Sanatanaha Manashrashtani Indriyani Prakritisthani Karshati. A part of myself becomes the eternal self in the world of beings and draws to itself the five senses with the mind as the sixth, abiding in the Prakriti. So, we'll see how Gyaneshwar Maharaj is explaining. If there is something to be added, we will add. So, in other words, here he is saying, Mamai Ansho Jivalok. So, a part of myself alone has come into the creation, into the Prakriti, or because of Prakriti, it's expressing as the Jiva. Jiva Bhuta Sanatanaha. I am of the nature of eternity. Jiva is also of the nature of eternity. Essentially. How? We will explain. Manashashtani Indriyani Prakritisthani Karshati. By attracting the Indriyas, the six Indriyas to it, and then utilizing them, he manifests himself in the Prakriti. Now with this, we start. That is a general understanding. I just added something extra, not added, but explained that as much as the Ishvara is, or the Lord is eternal, that much Jiva is also eternal. So what is the difference?
He knows it.
He knows it, we do. Now you know it. So,
still a test.
So are you Sanatan?
Yes.
Then you have to live like that. No. You have to live like that then. Not at the mercy of the world. Not as long as you are living a desire-oriented lifestyle, as long as you are accepting the multiplicity of the world as real, till then the Ishvara, which is your soul essence, it will not express. So Jiva without conditionings is Ishvara. See? So when we read in Amrit Anubhav that one Parama Shiva alone appears as Shiva Shakti, so it is an eternal phenomena. There Shiva Shakti is the eternal Jiva, Ishvara, and he is not subservient to his Shakti. They are coexisting. And he is very clear. We are not clear. We are not coexisting with our mind. We are not coexisting with the creation. We are afraid of the creation. We want to manipulate the creation. We want to take control of the creation. We want to use the creation to satisfy our desires. Lord does not do that. Ishvara doesn't do that. That is the difference between him and us. So change your disposition. And change does not mean that you have to change anything out there. You have to understand that all activities that are happening out of this equipment, they are happening. Stop taking ownership of it. Let them happen, but don't take ownership. Don't aspire, don't desire, don't want. Just keep watching. Slowly, slowly, the momentum will reduce. ऐसे शरीराची ये वढ़े जय आत्म आत्मज्ञान वेगळे पड़े तय माझा अंशु आवड़े थोड़े पणे समुद्र का वायु वशे तरंगाकार उल्लसे तो समुद्रांशु ऐसा दिसे सा निवाजेवी देवी जड़ाते जीवविता देहाहंता उपजविता मी जीव गमे पंडुसुता Jivaloki. He says in this way, the knowledge of self gets solely confined to the body, and because of its smallness, it appears as a part of myself. When a ripple is formed on the sea as a result of a breeze, it appears to be a part of the sea. In the same way, though I give consciousness and egoism to the inert body, I appear as the individual self in this body. So now, see, Sanatan, you can look at it in another way. Sanatan, how Jiva is Sanatan? Everyone knows that in a living person, someone is expressing through this body. When a person dies, you know someone is not expressing through this body. So who is that person? Was he there? Can he appear out of nothing? So he must have been there before. He is there now while the body, he was expressing through the body. And when the body does not support his expression, he continues his journey. So because he has left the, he is not expressing through the body, we say body is dead. We don't say soul is dead. Isn't it? If there is a reflection of the sun in the waters, if the water dries out, doesn't mean that reflection has died. The ability of the sun to express as a reflection is ever available. The medium should be there. So what is death? The medium. The body, breath, mind, intellect is not available to reflect consciousness. So that consciousness is continuous. Where has it become? Where is it? How can you say that it is born or it is dead? We never say consciousness is born. We always say body is born, a child is born, and our attention is on the name and form. We always say the body is dead. We don't say consciousness is dead. Look at it. So, as much as the Ishvara is eternal, this Jiva is also eternal. Understand, from Vedanta standpoint of view, there is only, the phenomena is only one. There are not many phenomena. So what is the first phenomena? I'm questioning. What is the first phenomena? That one without a second Paramatma appearing as if as Ishvara Prakriti. That is the phenomena. In that Ishvara, now everything else is imagined on account of the fluctuation of the Prakriti. Sattva Rajastama, Sattva Rajastama, Sattva Rajastama. Because that's her job. She cannot stay only in one state. The moment she becomes one state, then Shiva Shakti play will conclude. But as long as Shiva and Shakti are there, or Ishwar and Prakriti are there, the Prakriti will always go through the dance of Sattva Rajastamas, waking, dream, deep sleep, waking, dream, deep sleep, waking, dream, deep sleep. And this phenomena will go on at totality. This is at totality level, at Ishwara's level. It's continuously going on. In that one ocean, all the individual waves are imagined. They are part and parcel of the Ishwar only. But but the consciousness forgets its all-encompassingness, its all-pervasiveness. Why? It has happened. That is our situation, isn't it? That is where we are right now. Why it has happened, there is no question. It has happened. Now question is, are you ready to go back and reclaim your original nature? So here he says in the 346th OV, Pai jiva chiya bodha gocharu zoha dhanda to jiva loka shabda abhipravo aga upazane nimane he sats cize kamanane to jiva loku mi mane sandaruhana evam vidh jiva loki tu mate aisa avaloki जैसा चंद्रु का उदकी उदकातीत पै काश्मीराचा रवा कुंकुमावरी पांडवा आणिका गमे लोहिवा तो तरी नवे तैसे अनादिपण न मोडे माझे अक्रियत्व न खंडे परिकर्ता भोक्ता ऐसे आवडे ते जाण का भ्रांति. He says, Gyaneshwar Maharaj says, the activity that appears to go round due to the intellect of the embodied self is known as the world of living, the Jiva Loka. So what is intellect here? Conceptualization, imagination. What another way? What is intellect? Where the I thought expresses, isn't it? Without intellect, you cannot have the I thought. And that thought expresses in the mind. So that is, if you take it as just mind and intellect, then it is that where aham and idamvritti appear. It is that where the ego appears. And he just said before that I alone express as the ego and the life in a person. So when he says the word here, ahankar, that ahankar is not the individual ego. Ahankar is taken here as the principle. Which principle? That principle which even when you are not aware, it is taking care of the bodily functions. It is keeping the skin of the body together, all the five elements together, so that they don't disperse. That ahankar is absent in a dead body. Therefore, the dead body disperses. All the five elements with which it is made, they go back to their original elements. Not original elements, go back to their source. Go back to the total element. So in this manner, he says, the activity that appears to go around due to the intellect of the embodied self is known as the world of the living. So as long as we are in our mind and intellect, till then we are jivas. till we are in our mind and intellect, where duality is the norm, multiplicity is cognized, acceptance of the intellect that this body, breath, mind, intellect I am, this equipment I am, there the jivahood is prevalent and expressing. So, where birth and death are regarded as real. So not only just birth and death, time is accepted as real, space is accepted as real, directions are accepted as real, objects, everything that you see, hear, touch, feel, taste, think, ideate, conceptualize, everything is accepted as real. Relationships are accepted as real. Aspirations, ambitions, they are accepted as real. And what we are not accepting as real? The reality, the Ishvara, who is more real than any one of these, what we just narrated. Because these all come and go, but Ishvara doesn't come and go. And we are not ready to accept him, expressing through us that he is the essence and I am of his nature. We are not getting there. Why? Because of our obsession with all these lists that we just narrated. Where birth and death are regarded as real, janma mrityu, I call that the world of the living or mundane existence. This is stupid living. This is mundane, this is ephemeral, this is ignorant living. When your potential is to live independent of Prakriti, as the master of Prakriti, to coexist with Prakriti, to see that this entire expanse of Prakriti is nothing but your expanse, and you are choosing to live like a teeny meeny individual, only stuck in this body. Now what will you call this? It's height of stupidity. And majority of the people, including seekers, because they are seeking, they are still caught up in that mundane existence. But what about my duties? But what about my karma? But what about my past karmas? What about my vasanas? What about my children? What about it? I have given birth to my child and girl and daughter and son. Oh, is it not my responsibility to take care of them? Now where natural default is going in that direction, such a person is ignorant. I call that the world of the living or mundane existence, just as the moon, though different from water, is reflected in the water, so I exist in this world of the living. This is the Pratibimbavad. Did we talk about it last week in this class? The creation, advent of Jiva, of the phenomena, of the how the one expresses as many, many is afterwards, how that one expresses as the phenomena, exactly like the sun expresses as the bimba, pratibimba in the waters. See, that reflection is not touched by water. That reflection of the sun, or here the moon is taken, that reflection is not troubled by the waves. That reflection does not get wet. When there are too many waves, nothing happens to the reflection. it does not break up. Your eyes are seeing it broken up, but for it, it's not affected in any manner. That is, when you take yourself to be that way, that in spite of all the stimuli, in spite of all the thoughts, desires, actions, concepts, ideas, you don't get disturbed by it, because you are established in yourself, you are like that reflected moon or the sun in the water. As the reflection, the witnessing consciousness is the reflection, unaffected reflection. But if the reflection's attention is on the waves, oh my God, that big wave is coming and I'm going to drown in that wave and I'm going to be tossed up and down in that wave, immediately it has forgotten. So can there be many reflections of the moon or sun in the waters? No, only one. Can there be many Ishwaras? Only one Ishwara. But when that reflection gets identified with different waves or different pots, as if, but we are not going to go into that as if. Why? There, under any logical discussion, that reflection can never be identified with the equipment. It is not possible only. As much as you may work it out, that reflection cannot. So this is called Pratibimbavada. And the second one, maybe when it comes later, I'll tell you, it is called Avachedavad. That we will tell. Just as the moon, though different from water, is reflected in the water, so I exist in this world of the living. If a crystal is placed on red powder, it appears red, but in reality, it is not so. The crystal is absolutely pure, only appearing to be red. The world doesn't become blue because I'm wearing blue glasses. It doesn't become dark because I'm wearing dark glasses. It doesn't become yellow if I'm wearing yellow glasses. World is just as it is, exactly the same way. Here also, the self, because it is expressing through the layers of personalities, or layers of coverings, and that consciousness is expressing through them, just like our vision is expressing, is seeing through the blue glasses, so it cognizes the blue world. Similarly, consciousness expressing through body, breath, mind, intellect has a certain expression if it is identified with it. But are you affected with the blue world or the yellow world or the dark world? No, because you know. You know that this color of the world is because of the glasses. Actually speaking, this world is not of any color. The color of the glass is getting superimposed on every aspect of the creation. If you know that about yourself, that the quality of the body is making me go through heat, cold, pain and etc., comfort, discomfort. The breath is making me, because I'm expressing through breath, the hunger and thirst comes. So let it come, but don't get agitated, don't get reactionary, don't get disturbed if it comes or it doesn't come. So same way with mind, its likes and dislikes, and intellect, it is praise and insult. More so, if waking and dream and deep sleep come and go, don't get disturbed. They are also happening at the intellect level. So where is it, here or in the next one? Okay. it says here, just as the moon, though different from water, is reflected in the water, so I existed in this world of the living. If a crystal is placed on red powder, it appears red, but in reality it is not so. In the same way, my original nature, as beginningless and inactive, remains unaffected. So, can you attribute ownership, doership, enjoyership on the reflected sun? That it is enjoying the waves, that it is creating the waves. Can you say? Cannot, no? That's our position. If you recognize this position about yourself, that I am that one in whose presence all changes at the various sheath level are happening, then you are at the phenomenal level. Then what? Where are you? You are at the Jiva Bhava level. And who is Jiva? Where he has forgotten this Jiva Bhav, but he has come to identify with the conditionings. Beginningless and inactive and remains unaffected. If I appear to be the doer and the experiencer, know that it is due to delusion. So again, what is the difference between Ishvara and Jiva? Jiva is under the spell of delusion, which we call maya, ignorance, incomplete knowledge about himself. This is delusion. And as a result of that delusion, he experiences everything as Triputi, subject, object, and instrument of knowledge. Whereas, what is his essential nature? Imagine that reflected sun or the moon is now forgetting himself as the Pratibimb and is identified with every wave and getting tossed around. It's lost. It's lost himself. So where does he go when the wave dies? He feels, I am going, I don't know, I don't want to go to hell, I don't want to go to heaven. Not possible. Because that Pratibimb, that reflection, whether there is wave or not there, it will always be there as a reflection. And what is reflection? That which is existing in its own absence. Understand this also. Understand this also, that this life, which is this expression of the consciousness through the equipment, is also a phenomena. Phenomena is that which is existing in its own absence. And therefore we use the word as if, eva, eva, eva. Due to delusion. So, where there is no expression or doership and enjoyership, there Ishvara is expressing. Simple. So give up doership, give up ownership, give up enjoyership. Then you are happy for no reason. See, all desires are for the doer. All desires are for the doer because he has taken that position. You cannot do anything without having a desire. Ishvara, what happens to Ishvara? Does he have a desire? Then what does he have? Yeah, but that is besides the point. But what happens to Ishvara and the desire? Wherever there is a phenomena, desire will express. So, what is the situation of Ishvara then?
No ownership. No ownership.
No ownership, okay. But what else?
Beyond the
See, when you use these words, both of you or whatever is going on in your mind, you are thinking Ishvara as an entity beyond the world. You are not seeing this world also as an expression of Ishvara. So, who is Ishvara? Ishvara is He in whom all the desires are spontaneously forever satisfied. Every moment. Think. So make yourself in that position. At any given moment, if you are absolutely content that whatever will be, que sera sera. I want nothing from this world, I got nothing to give to this world. Because everything is perfect just the way it is. Not because you are looking at everything, it's because of this, because of the
phenomenon.
Because you have come to understand that I am that who is complete. So then you stop getting buffeted by every stimuli that comes to you. Ishvara doesn't get. Ishvara also responds, depends upon the intensity of the stimuli. If Ishvara is sitting there, lying there in Ananta Shayana in meditation, he doesn't come out, acha chalo, mere ko kuch karna hai. Nahin. If Hiranyakashipu is born and he has created enough havoc, then by the, and that is also his expression only, then he comes out. Why? For bringing, establishing the dharma. But that is avataran. Just like a mother is available to a child only when the child is calling the mother, isn't it? Otherwise she is not available. She knows he is fine, he is happy. But here, you have to, these examples that we are taking are still very limited. Ishvara is all that there is. Ishvara is the all-encompassing principle. All desires are fulfilled. We can't imagine what is it like to be where all desires are fulfilled, because we have never experienced. We have never experienced that. Continuing. Where are we? 55. Kim bahuna atma chokhatu houni prakriti si ekavatu bandhe prakriti dharma chapatu apanapaya pay manadi sahi indriye shrotradi prakriti karye tie mazi manoni hoe vyapara rudh. जैसे स्वप्नी परिव्राजे आपण पया आपण कुटुंब होइजे मगतया चे निधाविजे मोहय सैरा तैसा आपलिया विस्मृति आत्मा आपणची प्रकृति सारिखा गमोनी पुढती तियेसीची भजे मनाच्या रथी वळघे श्रवणाचिया द्वारे निघे मग शब्दाचिया रिघे Rana Mazi. He says, Jnaneshwara Maharaj says that in short, the pure self coming into conjunction with Prakriti attributes its properties to himself. Then he regards the mind and the senses, which are the products of the Prakriti, as his own and becomes involved in the worldly affairs. So understand. Paramatma, whom are we talking about? Paramatma. Who is Paramatma? Nirgun Nirakar. Willingly accepting the potentiality. He invoked the potentiality, and now, having accepted the expression of his potentiality, what is potentiality? Desire. Or name and form, whatever, which Prakriti, Trigunatmikat Prakriti, having accepted her as his own Vibhuti, as his own part, amsha. Now that same Paramatma, which was Nirgun Nirakar, is now Saguna Sakar. Why? He has chosen to be, he has accepted the Prakriti as Prakriti, which means there is a thought of Prakriti in his mind. That's why the mind came about, isn't it? That itself is Prakriti. But he is not, Ishvara is not subservient. He is not enslaved. He is not under the clutches. He plays. He knows it is his potentiality. She also knows that she is not other than him. She cannot be without him. And he knows it is his potential. So his view is, I am only expressing. So if I am only expressing, do I have a desire for my own hand? Do I have a desire for my own thoughts? Do I have a desire for my own breath? No. What is mine, I don't have a desire for. And if I have created out of myself, how can I have a desire for that? So if I have created the dream world and the waking world out of myself, how can I have a desire for it? Think. But we are, that is the state, condition of Ishvara. Where are we? We are desiring. We are desiring. So he says here, then he regards the mind and the senses, which are the products of Prakriti, as his own, and becomes involved in the worldly affairs. And what is worldly affairs? Going through the three states, waking, dream, deep sleep, waking, dream, deep sleep. So that one Paramatma now is expressing as Brahma, Vishnu, Mahesh and Allah at the totality. That one Ishvara is now expressing as Brahma, Vishnu, Mahesh, creator, maintainer and destroyer. And the Leela goes on. Just as a monk becomes his own family in a dream and becoming infatuated, exerts himself to maintain it, so the self, forgetting his essential nature, takes himself to the body and dances in attendance to it. See, sometimes when you are dreaming, the dream is so real. Dream is so real that you get up from the sleep due to some unwanted happening in the dream. Sometimes you wake up sweating because of the fear in the dream, because you have taken it to be so real. Sometimes you wake up from the dream screaming because of what has happened in the dream, because you took it to be real. See? But after waking up, you say, this is a bekuf. So this is what Mahatmas tell us, bekuf. Buddhu, because they have woken up to the waking also. We have not woken up to the waking. Forgetting his essential nature, takes himself to be the body and dances attendance to it. You know, sometimes if you have noticed in your life, or even nowadays, sometimes some thought comes and sticks in your mind, a desire that I want to do something. And then you don't have the resources, that thought is there in the mind continuously. And things, because you are entertaining that thought again and again and again and again, because it's fascinating, because it is giving you hope, because it is giving you a sense of success, it is giving you a sense of pride, it is giving you a sense of whatever you have attributed it to. You feel you are a better person if that particular desire has manifested. And sometimes people spend an entire lifetime thinking about that one desire, isn't it? how to convert electricity into light. The theory of relativity. How many years Einstein spent on it? But eventually he did. And when he did, after that, what? Nothing. He said, I wasted my time. He says, I wasted my time. It was the most obvious thing. It was the most obvious thing that energy and mass never get lost. That apple falling is because of gravity is the most obvious. By having discovered what great have I done, it was already present, that principle. Think. And yet we move through life. Sometimes our mind or consciousness is hijacked by a desire. I'll tell you in total terms. Sometimes this consciousness hijacked by the waking world. Sometimes it's hijacked by the dream world. And then in the wake, just like we get so involved in the dream family or events that you wake up screaming or you wake up due to a shock or excitement or ecstasy. Similarly, in the waking world also, we are continuously getting hijacked by relations, by possessions, by aspirations, by ambitions, by fear, by insecurity, by jealousy. We are getting hijacked. Iswara doesn't get hijacked. Iswara doesn't get hijacked. He is aware, he knows who he is. And he allows the Prakriti to unfold according to her gati, according to her destiny. So he doesn't interfere with Prakriti. No, you should not do this. Oh, no, you should not do this. Oh, don't do this. Oh, don't do that. You want to do it? If she asks, oh Lord, what should I do? Don't go to your father's place. You will be insulted. No, it's my father, this, that. She faced the consequence. She had to burn her life, herself alive out of disgust for her father. But because she loved Shiva and calls out to Shiva, Shiva goes to help her out again in her next birth. So whether it is Radha, whether it is Shakti, whether it is Sita, Ramchandra ji told Sita ji, don't go, there is nothing called a golden deer. No, but you don't want to go and you think I am hallucinating. Yeah, but I want the golden deer. And he was made to go. So Prakriti has to face the consequences of its own action. Whether it is Sita, whether it is Shakti, whether it is the Navadurgas, whether it is whatever, Iswara is the mere witness. Now, having understood this principle, apply it on yourself. All the gods are within you. Sun, Moon, Ashwini Kumar, Vishnu, Rudra, Saraswati, all gods are within this microcosm. Watch them. Don't get influenced by them. Let them do what they are supposed to do under a particular circumstance. Just like Iswara does. If the Prakriti asks Iswara, if the mind says, oh Lord, what should I do in this situation? Then the self will answer. If it is remembering the Lord. No, I think I know what I have to do. I got it all worked out. Gone. We have dug our own grave. This is Jiva. So how does Jiva transcend Prakriti? By thinking of the total Jiva. I'm using these words just so that you understand. By thinking about the total Jiva. And that is the total Jiva in which all the individual Jivas are included. Past, present and future. He is a Ishvara. He is Ishvara. So when you think of Ishvara, automatically you will transcend the Prakriti. Because he is ever unaffected by Prakriti. So in this manner, we bring about this shift in consciousness. In this manner, we transcend the Prakriti. So here he says that which are the products of the Prakriti as his own and becomes involved in Berlin, just as a monk, okay, example was taken, forgetting his essential nature, takes himself to be the body and dances attendance on it. Just like, now think, another example that is coming to my mind. The moon is, there is a reflected moon in the waters. When the waves come, what happens to the moon? You can't see the full reflection, isn't it? You can't see the full reflection. Now what are you seeing? You are seeing a sparkle of the moon, the light reflecting on every wave. And now it seems that that light is dancing, or sometimes if the waves are, there is a gap between the waves, it seems the moon is dancing on the water, but actually the water is dancing. So this illusion of moon dancing, when we look in the sky, it's clouds are moving, but we say, hey, look, moon is moving. As kids, we all tried to work it out, isn't it? But moon is not moving, the clouds are moving. Exactly the same way. The Prakriti is changing, self is never changing. Ishvara knows this, Jiva doesn't know this. Get out of this wrong notion. And then it says, then he rides in the chariot of the mind and passing out through the ears, he enters the woods of speech. So, how it is expressing. So first there is a desire, then that desire then expresses as speech. Because whatever the desire is, it has, desire is always for something, of something, isn't it? Now 356. Tochi prakriti cha vagora tvache chiya mohara ani sparsha chiya ghora vanazaya kone eke avasari rigoni netracha dwari magarupacha dongari saira hinde karasane chiya vata nighoni gasubhata rasacha darakuta bharochi lage natari yene chi ghrane zaide haanshu kari nighane mag gandhaji darune aadave langhi aiseni dehendriya nayake gharuni manazavalike bhogi zati shabdadike vishaya bharane. He says, when he holds on to the apron of Prakriti, what is Prakriti now? Think in other words. When he holds on to matter, okay, that's another word for it. What else? He holds on to?
Desires.
He holds on to desires. He holds on to ignorance. He holds on to his limited beingness.
Illusion.
He holds on to the illusion as real. As real. Now don't think this is a fantastic idea. Holding on to the illusion as real means you considering yourself to be the body. This is the illusion we are talking about. Then you holding on to being a father, mother, daughter, sister, that is virtual. Gaunatma. Accepting yourself to be the body, breath, mind, intellect is the mithyatma, illusory self. We are taking it to be real. And who are you? The mukhyatma, the real self. So here he says that when he holds on to the apron of prakriti, when he holds on to the incomplete knowledge as complete, when he holds on to the ignorance and says, no, this is what is real, when he holds on to waking dream and deep sleep and says, no, this is the real world, when he holds on to body, breath, mind, intellect and says, no, this is, see, it is solid, it is real. Even though the world is continuously slipping out of his fingers, still he sees, considers it to be continuous. It is not continuous. It is an illusion of continuity which he is holding on to. Passing, then he, where are we? When he holds on to the apron of prakriti, he goes through the door of skin into the thick forest in the form of touch. So now he is becoming enslaved by the senses. So from the skin he goes out and starts feeling. Through the eyes he goes out and he starts seeing. Through the ears he goes out, he starts hearing. First the hearing happened. Goes out of the nose, he starts smelling. Goes out of the tongue, starts tasting. All this was because of the wrong identification. Because he considered, when they say here, he held on to the apron of ignorance. In other words, he has forgotten his essential nature, and whatever is present in front of him, he is taking that to be a reality. And it's happening like this. You can slow it down. As a seeker, you can slow it down and then go back. But when it happens suddenly. Just as quickly, the moment you look at her, you become a husband. When you look at me, you become a student. It's instantaneous. Sometimes he comes out through the door of the eyes and roams freely on the mountains of form. O warrior, he passes out through the passage of the tongue and wanders in the valley of taste. Or when this part of myself comes out through the exit of the nose, he roves in the dense forest of smell. In this way, taking the help of the mind, the embodied self, who is the lord of the body and the senses, enjoys the sense objects such as the sound, etc. Now understand, Ishwara is also doing the same, you are also doing the same. Then what is the difference? You are doing it through one body. Ishwara, if we want to use the word, if we want to see him, that he is experiencing everything, then spontaneously, simultaneously, he is expressing through each and every sense. Therefore, Om Sahasra Shirsha Purushaha Sahasraksha Sahasrapad. So he is expressing through all the eyes, through all the five senses, seeing all the ears, all the noses, all the tongues, all the skin, all the minds, all the feet, all the hands. It's a fantastic concept which has been presented to you, and if you start thinking about it, you will vanish. What will vanish? Individuality will vanish. The ignorant individuality will vanish. And in its place, Ishwaratva will start expressing. Even if you contemplate on this, there is no answer. How? Just like, if you want to take it to make it subjective, just like spontaneously, without thinking, without desiring, you are expressing through every organ of your body, through every limb of your body, through every cell of your body. There's no desire for it, but it's happening, isn't it? So for that cell, individual cell, you are the Ishwara. Think. These are the fantastic visions that are given in our scriptures to destroy the mind. To destroy the mind in one, from one angle, or to re-educate the mind so that it ever remains aware of the source, ever remains in love with the source. In an individual, it is in love with the multiplicity. So what is the difference between Shiva and Shakti, or Ishwara and Prakriti? Prakriti is ever in love with her beloved. Radha is ever in love with her beloved. Shakti is ever in love with Shiva. Sita is eternally in love with her Ram. Yet, at times, the separation happens. Why it happens? Is it because of Ishwara? Then?
It's desire of...
Sita was a realized master. Then why did he go after the... Why did she go after the deer? Sati, who has invoked Lord Shiva and Lord Shiva has presented herself and then married her. How come she's not... And she has signed the contract that these are the 11 things that I will do. He says, if you do, then you can be my wife. I'll marry you. She agrees. And yet she doesn't listen to him. How? Why? Why this happens? You never find Ramchandra ji making the mistake. You never find Lord Shiva making the mistake. You always find the Prakriti or the Shakti going against the will of the Master, the Ishwara. Why?
She is the one who created the deity.
Okay.
But is it because one is stable and the other one is turbulent?
Good. Because it is her nature to be fluctuating, to be oscillating. The nature of Prakriti is, what is it? Change. Isn't it? And therefore, all these stories, we see this principle expressing. Even though that Sita is, because when Ramchandra ji and Sita ji came together, both of them had realized so masters. Then they came together. Yet this is happening. It's because of the nature. And that nature, we should not condemn Prakriti here. No. Then why is she doing that? Yes, it is her nature. Secondly, that nature is not other than the Ishwara. Therefore, it is the Leela going on. So, Ishwara playing with himself, and when he plays with himself, the part of himself which he plays with, that part is called Prakriti, which has come out of himself. See? So, has mind come from outside? Make it subjective. Where has mind come from? Has it come from outside? Has someone put an injection in you and placed the mind there? Mind came out of you only. It is part and parcel of you. It's part and parcel of you. And if that is your potentiality, understand, you have created it to play with yourself. So let it be a leela rather than a serious affair. Rather than or Krishna himself is expressing as Arjuna and playing the game. Isn't it? To look at yourself in this manner is the learning from here. Mamaivasho jivaloke jiva bhuta sanatanaha manashashtani indriyani. What is that? Prakriti sthani karshati. O warrior, he passed. We saw all that. In this way, taking the help of the mind, the embodied self, who is the lord of the body and the senses, enjoys the sense objects such as the sound, taste, touch, etc. If the mind is not there, this enjoying cannot happen.
Impression.
Attachment cannot happen. Seeking cannot happen. And what is this mind? Again, I am saying it. What is this mind? It's potentiality. It is the prakriti. So where is this whole world? Within the prakriti. It is an expression of prakriti. Where are you seeing it? Outside the mind, isn't it, at the moment? You see it out there. And you say, my mind is in here and the world is out there. Actually speaking, the entire world, past, present, future, including this body, breath, including the word mind, is within the mind. Individuality, totality, truth, everything is a thought only in the mind, isn't it? That is the potentiality. Ishwara doesn't need a language to communicate because he's all-knowing, isn't it? And yet he uses language when Prakriti comes in front of him. But because he is using language, he has not become an individual. He continues to remain Ishwara. Even when he is giving Bhagavad Gita to us, he is continuing to be the Ishwara. Therefore, he can see the big picture and present it in a format so that the prakriti benefits, the potentiality benefits. In this case, the potentiality which has manifested out of himself is Arjuna. In us, if we are having a dialogue, what is the dialogue we are having with our potentiality, the mind? Is it like Bhagavad Gita, or is it but kab isko ye bolna band karega pata nahi? You see, so your quality of communication has to be of that caliber. Yeah, beautiful na. Where are we? Now we come to the 8th verse. So having told that the jiva is nothing but a part and parcel of me, and as much as I am eternal, to the same extent the jiva is also eternal. The principle of jiva we are talking about, and principle of jiva is because Ishwara identified with equipment, prakriti is identified, is called jiva. Jiva disidentified with prakriti is Ishwara. It's that simple. Then why are we itta papad kyu bol rahe hum? If it's that simple, because we only complicate it by thinking too much, by trying to work it out, by taking ownership that I have to do something. 8th verse says, so now how the attachment begins of that Ishvara, of that conscious principle with the equipments, with the Prakriti. Shariram yadavapnoti yachapyukramati Ishvaraha gruhit vaitani sanyati vayur gandhani vashayat. He says, when the Lord, the Self, acquires a body and also when he abandons it, he departs taking these with him as the wind carries fragrance from its source. Just like, how does he depart? It is a departing without departing. It is a departure without departing. When we all depart from this house, we'll go away somewhere, isn't it? And we'll land somewhere else. But here it is but even if you say that there is a departure, how does it depart? Just like the fragrance is, when the breeze flows over the rose bed, and when it passes over the rose bed, the fragrance is of the roses is carried by the breeze to the rest of the world, isn't it? Has the rose lost anything? Nothing is lost, nothing is gained. So this is the point that I already made it, that the Jiva is also Sanatan. So even though we see that consciousness has left the body, a physical body, and we call that person dead, but the person, the soul or the consciousness continues to be. It never gets lost. Because we break the walls of the house, the space has not died. The space was called individual space on account of the conditionings of the wall. When the walls are broken, the space at that very moment becomes the infinite space. Same way, when the wave dies, what happens to the water in the wave which was identified with its form, with birth and death? It becomes the ocean. It merges back into the origin, that is the ocean. What happens to you as an individual? You go to heaven? Yes, you will go to heaven if you have a concept of heaven in your mind and you are seeking it out. Yes, hell is there if you are afraid because of all the deeds, wrong deeds that you have done in life, then you will go to hell. Or wherever, whatever you have imagined. But if you are very clear in your understanding, through satsangs, through contemplation, that after, this verse tells us that after death, nothing is lost. Nothing is lost. All that happened was the conditioning through which the consciousness was expressing, that conditioning has become unmanifest, unable to support the consciousness. So what has happened to consciousness? It continues to be consciousness. There's nowhere to go. There's nowhere to come. If the phone becomes unfunctional, what happens to the internet or to the signal? It's still there. The phone is not functioning. What can the signal do? Here he says, परीकर्ता भोक्ता ऐसे हे जीवा चेतैसी दिसे जय शरीरी का पैसे एकाधिये जैसा आथिला काणी विलासिया तैची वोळखे वोळखो ये धनंजया जय राजसे व्याठाया वस्ती सी ये. How come there? Ah, there's ye. तैसा अहंकर्तृत्वाचा वाढू का विषयेंद्रियाचा धुमाडू हा जाणी जय तैने वाढू जय देह पाविजे अथवा शरीराते सांडी तरही इंद्रियांची तांडी हे आपण यासवे काढी घेऊनी जाय जैसा अपमानिला अतिथी ते ने सुकृताची संपत्ती का साईख डेयाची गती सूत्रतंतू नाना मावळतेनी तपने ने जेती लोकांची दर्शने हे असो द्रुती पवने ने जे जैसी देवी मनषष्ठां ययां इंद्रियांते धनंजया देह राजू न देहा पासुनी गेला. He says when this embodied self enters the body, he thinks that he is the doer and experiencer. How does he enter? By identification. If he doesn't enter, then what is he? Or who is he? Ishwara. So if where is your understanding, where you are? Inside this body. So you have accepted this body as I. Ishwara doesn't accept any body as I and yet accepts everything as he thinks that he is the doer and experiencer. So the moment we get identified with one body alone, that very moment the knower, the experiencer, the doer, the enjoyer are born. Just as, O winner of wealth, a rich and pleasure-loving person is recognized when he settles down in the capital city, so when the embodied self takes on this body, his ego gains strength and his senses and their objects become turbulent. How do you know they become turbulent? How do you know they become strong? Do you know that the memory becomes strong? How do you know that the I becomes strong? Watch a small child grow up. Watch your life from when you were a kid till today. How strong you have become. How responsible you have become. So what is realization? Be irresponsible. But we have become responsible. So he says, so when the embodied self takes on his body, the ego gains strength and his senses and their objects become turbulent. So once you own that I am this body, that I am so many years old, that I have got good, I am functioning through the eyes and the five senses and the mind, that I can make decisions. Like one lady came yesterday and she said, Swamiji, can you help me? I said, what? She says, oh, my husband has passed away and I have never done any banking and I don't know where to start. Where to start? She doesn't even know how the money is taken out from the ATM. Imagine what all I have to do. I have to take her to show how to take the money out of ATM. Because everything the husband was doing, he only gave her cash. She doesn't know which bank the accounts are, where are the banks, how do you go to the teller. Nothing she knows. That ignorant. See? But now she has to learn.
She must be happy earlier.
Huh? Yes, ignorance is bliss. No doubt, ignorance is bliss. But do we want to live like that? See? We want to be consciously ignorant. If we can put a pun on it. Consciously ignorant. That is Nirvikalpa Samadhi. So he says, strength and his senses and their objects become turbulent. Once you own the eyes, the moment eyes open, you cannot stop the continuous bombardment of forms on your eyes. Once you take the accept that I am the hearer behind the ears, that these are my ears, you cannot stop the sounds from bombarding the eardrum. And so also with the all the senses. Once you accept you are the mind, you cannot stop the tsunami of thoughts. It keeps coming one after wave after wave, just like the ocean beach. Waves keep coming, keep coming, keep coming. Sometimes they are gentle, sometimes they are turbulent, but they are incessant. It never stops. Exactly the same way. The waves keep coming, the waking dream sleep, waking dream sleep, waking dream sleep, waking dream sleep. Keep coming to and dashing against you. Either you drown in them, or you complain, why this is happening to me? Why there are so many waves? Why can't they be quiet? Why can't they be... Some people, majority of the people, when they see turbulent waves, they are afraid. And yet there are people, when they see turbulent waves, they say, Yahoo! And they go and surf on it, isn't it? Because they mastered it. Which one are you? Who is running away from everything that is coming? Or when he departs from the body, he takes along with him the retinue of the senses. So what happens at the time of death? Just like the breeze takes the fragrance from the rose bed, exactly the same way, the consciousness goes with the memories or the vasanas along. Vasanas, vasa, smell, fragrance. So the consciousness goes with the fragrance of the personality and continues and finds another conditioning from where it can express. Just as a dishonored guest carries with him the merit of his hosts, or with the snapping of the string the movements of the puppet sees, or when the sun sets, he takes away the vision of the people, or when the wind blows, it carries away the fragrance. So, Dhananjaya, when the embodied self discards the body, he takes with himself the five organs of knowledge and the sixth organ, the mind. How beautiful the examples given, na? That's the uniqueness here. Just like when the strings are cut, the puppet ceases to move, body stops moving. The other example is, when the sun sets, he takes away the vision of the people. You can't see anything in darkness. And just as a dishonored guest takes away his opinion about the host, good or bad. Just like that. No, there is no exchange. There is nothing that he is carrying away from there. Exactly the same way, when the consciousness departs, when a person is dead, it departs with the vasanas, the fragrance of the personality. And what is personality?
Impressions.
The impressions on the mind. So, be alert. Be vigilant. What type of thoughts we entertain? What do we allow our senses to interact with? How do we interact with what world is throwing at us? How do we talk to ourselves? Because maximum impressions are created by us talking to ourselves, not by outside. When we meet the outside world, it is only at the periphery. When we process it in our own mind, when we are all by ourselves, that is the time when the impressions, it no doubt outside also, but more so on our own. When the embodied discards the body, he takes with himself the organs of knowledge and the sixth organ, the five organs of knowledge, the seeing, hearing, touching, feeling, tasting in tanmatra form. In tanmatra form. Because where are these five senses?
In the mind.
Their mind expressing grossly is these five senses. So mind is knowledge, but that knowledge, mind cannot access knowledge. So it expresses as the five senses, and the five, through the five senses we access the stimuli. But understand, Ishvara alone is expressing through every stage of expression. He alone is the potentiality, the mind. He alone, the potentiality expanding itself, appear expressing as the mind, intellect and the five senses. Then, if five senses are created, for what purpose? So then, all the stimuli for the five senses is also the Ishvara. So the material world is Ishvara, the potentiality has come out of Ishvara, and the Ishvara is, through his potentiality, is playing with the world, which is none other than him. Take this position in life. So beautiful. But you have to accept that just like the dream is a projection of my mind, the waking is also a projection of my mind. Then you will play with it. Otherwise, you will succumb to it. You will complain about it. You have to accept this first. Then the next one says, the journey continues, the identity. Shrotram chakshu sparshanam cha rasanam ghranam eva cha adhishthaya manashchayam vishayanupasevate. We'll see that in our next class, which will be on the 10th of October. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Harihi Om. Just sit quietly for a minute or so.